So today we have a special guest, all the way from University Science Malaysia. So Dr. Zarina Matno, well, actually she is also one of our ACE Sedai Fellow and also a senior lecturer under the School of Distance Education USM, and also a member of International Network for Child Support Scholars. So I think today Dr. Zarina would like to share with us about the topics is actually the divorcing the children. Child support paradox in Malaysia. So I think without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Zarina to start the sharing session. So it's all yours, Dr. Zarina.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Rizal, and Assalamualaikum and a very good morning, everyone. Yeah, I haven't been presenting for quite some time already because of the COVID, so no more conferences and whatsoever. So yeah, it's a bit, I'm a bit, what we call it, worried about now. Yeah, because I'm presenting to distinguished lecturers from AIU and from BC there, right? From Dato' Aziz. Okay, thanks to AIU actually for accepting my application to do my sabbatical in AIU, and also for granting my team and I the grant for us to work on. And unfortunately, due to this COVID, we are a bit slow, yeah, in the progress. And today, thanks for the opportunity given to me to share my research. Actually, my PhD is not like in child support field or whatsoever. It's actually more on equity market, the share market, because I'm studying about the momentum of the equity market in Asian countries, in ASEAN 5 actually. But after I came back from my PhD, so I'm more interested in this poverty thing actually. Yeah, so and I'm focusing on single mother in Malaysia. So this presentation, Divorcing the Children, Child Support Paradox in Malaysia, is actually talking about child support payment, yeah, to divorce single mother in Malaysia. So as just a brief introduction. So actually, child support provisions set out the nature of financial liabilities. Yeah, financial liabilities expected of divorced parent, and especially for in our case, to the divorced father to support their children. And as we can see here, the government policies is not actually sufficient. Yeah, to improve the delivery and enforcement of child support from absent fathers. And child support payment is very, very crucial in supplementing the income of single mothers, because the proportion of income that has to be allocated in raising children increases as the children grow. And as we know now, the cost of living is yeah, increasing day by day. And with this COVID pandemic, everything becomes bit more costly than before. So, and actually, studies on child support and on single mothers around the world has consistently found, yeah, that financial hardship has affected the single mother the most. Yeah, even in Malaysia, if we refer to the Department of Statistics data, we can see that female household, female headed household, yeah, they are more prone to poverty. And in Malaysia, the custody of the children is usually given to mothers, while fathers have the visitation right upon divorce. And this is like the common practice in Malaysia. And when we talk about Malaysia, the context is that we are talking about the divorced mothers. But if we read the literature, yeah, from other countries, the Western countries, we are talking about mostly on unmarried mothers, yeah, because they have like a huge problem there with this child support. So a regular and more importantly, the sufficient amount of payment of child support can reduce, yeah, the burden of the mothers in raising the children. And also in doing so, it will maintain their financial well-being. So for the context of the study, this is actually a part of poverty study because I'm quite interested in this poverty study, but I'm focusing on poor single mother, yeah, because they are the most affected in single mother group, yeah. And this research actually is a qualitative research, and it explores the experiences of divorced Malay single mothers, but I will be sharing the results of my research university grant from USM, whereby not only the Malay mothers, we include also the Indian and the Chinese mothers, but the numbers of these non-Malay mothers is very small actually, because we had hard time finding these mothers, even though I have like three postgraduate students doing their masters, and they were also having hard time to find the non-Malay mothers, yeah. Okay, so I have a note here. It is important to note that in Malaysian society, children are expected to be born from marital bonds, yeah, whereby premarital or out of wedlock birth is not like normally acceptable, yeah. And for this study, we see the meanings of child support payment to the livelihood of single mother households, yeah, focusing on the low income single mothers. And also in Malaysia, the published empirical research on child support is very, very limited. There are some studies, and some of them are like PhD thesis or master thesis, but they are not really published. So most of the references come from research from overseas, yeah, in the Western from the Western countries. So as a background, Malaysia dual legal system for child support claim, because we have the Sharia and we have the civil courts, yeah. So the civil and Sharia court exist side by side in our legal system. So there are two laws defending child support in Malaysia. The first one is for the Muslim, the 1984 Islamic law, and the other one for the non-Muslim are the Married Women and Children Maintenance Act 1950 or MWCMA 1950. And they have some revision for this one as well. So we just go, we just touch a little on the 1984 Islamic law. In section 72.1 and 72, the Islamic Family Law, Federal Territory Act 1984, it specifies that except where an agreement or order of court otherwise provides, it shall be the duty of a man to maintain his children, whether they are in his custody or the custody of any other person, either by providing them with such accommodation, clothing, food, medical attention, and education as are reasonable, having regard to his means and station in life, or by paying the cost thereof. Because in our family law, we always have to base the amount of payment on the ability of the father to pay. The second one, except as aforesaid, it shall be the duty of a person liable under hukum syariah, hukum syarak, Sharia law, to maintain or contribute to the maintenance of children if the father is dead or his whereabouts are unknown, or if and so far as he is unable to maintain them. This is an issue here actually, yeah, because the practice of our people now is that only the father is liable to pay for the child support, but actually under the Sharia law, the family of the father, yeah. If the father was dead or we do not know where he is, yeah, it happens actually. So the grandfather or the uncle from the father's side have to provide the child support for the children. Actually, there are efforts, yeah, by the Sharia court to enforce this law, but it's still not it's not passed yet, yeah. So maintenance according to the provision includes accommodation, food, medical attention, and education. And if you look at the law for the non-Muslim, yeah, the right to child support are stated in the Married Women and Children Maintenance Act 1950. Act 263 state that the court may make order for maintenance of wife and children. One, if any person neglect or refuse to maintain his wife or a legitimate child of his which is unable to maintain itself, the court upon due proof thereof may order such person to make a monthly allowance for the maintenance of his wife or such child in proportion to the means of such person as to the court seems reasonable. Two, if any person neglects or refuses to maintain an illegitimate child, okay, this act is a bit different because it includes the illegitimate child, of his which is unable to maintain itself, same thing as the first one. Such allowance shall be payable from the date of such neglect or refusal or from such a later date as may be specified in the order. Okay, and there is a reform in 1976 that states that the court may pass an order for custody either to one of his or her parents unless the particular child is entrusted to either parent, then the court may pass an order for custody to a relative of the child, welfare association or any other person whom the court deems suitable. And another important amendment is that a father of a divorced couple is now duty bound to maintain his child until the completion of the child's higher education or training under Section 95 of the Act, when previously the law required a father to maintain his child until the child turned 18 only. Okay, so this is the latest amendment whereby the father has to maintain to support the child or the children until they finish their education, tertiary education. So in essence, both the Sharia law and the civil law have stated that the right of the children to maintain and child support. So court ordered child support is the main method used for mothers in Malaysia to obtain child support. Although some of them may have come up with an out of court agreement on child support payment, because in order to claim for child support, they have to get the official custody from the court. So they have to go through a few processes. And if there is no contest from the father, then the custody of the mother will be, the children will be given to the mother and the father will have the visitation right. Nevertheless, the payment of child support has regularly become a long-standing issue among divorced parents. And this is not only happened in Malaysia, it happens all over the world. Because I have attended a few conferences specifically on this child support issue and also the trans-border child support issue in a few countries, and they've been talking about this. It's very, very hard actually to get child support, especially in Western countries whereby the mothers have moved to other countries or the father have moved to other countries. So now they are talking about what we call it, trans-border child support arrangement. And unfortunately, Malaysia is yet to sign not the agreement. Actually, there's a like, I'm sorry, I can't remember the word now. Okay, not the agreement. So now there will be an issue for Malaysian to claim child support if the father had moved to other countries or the mother had moved to other countries. But for us, probably this is not a big issue. But for developed nation, the developed countries, they have this kind of issue. A lot of them have this kind of issue. But for Malaysia, we are still very much restricted to only child support issue within our own border. And it's interesting to note that in 2008, actually, the Family Support Section, FSS, was established by the Department of Sharia Judiciary in Malaysia. And their function is to oversee the enforcement and execution of child support orders. When the Sharia court issue orders, so they will make sure that the orders will be respected by the fathers. And at one point, because there were so many issues and these mothers didn't get any payment and the children will suffer and everything, so these FSS went to the extent of prepaying the child support arrears to the mothers, and with the intention, with the good intention of recollecting the payment from the fathers. But the reality is different. The FSS couldn't sustain the payment because they were unable to make the fathers pay. or they were unable to locate the whereabouts of the fathers, because in some cases the father is just disappear. Okay, and when I talked to this officer in Putrajaya, yeah, and they were saying that sometimes they have to use the police, yeah, to locate the father, and sometimes when they found the father, he just said, "I don't want to pay." So what else can they do? Yeah. So as of now, the FSS focuses more on providing legal advice, yeah, to the Muslim, to the divorced family in regards to their rights and claim on child support. These FSS officer will update or will get in touch with the mothers and ask them whether they receive regular payment based on the court orders and everything. Yeah, if but sometimes their action or their ability to help also limited. Yeah, because it will depend on the willingness of the father to pay. Yeah. So the motivation of the research, yeah, actually child support is a delicate issue, yeah, from personal to policy perspective, because it has to balance, yeah, the complex thing, the complex needs between children, resident parents, and non-resident parents, and also the government, yeah, because when these kind of things happen, and the government needs to involve. So, and the most important thing that we have to remember in these kind of cases is that the real victims are the children, especially from the poor single mother household. Okay, and these children will be the future of our country. So, and also, it can lead to the persistence of intergenerational poverty, as we can see now. Yeah. One generation is poor, and then the next generation also will be poor because of so many things. They cannot get the necessary support. They cannot get the necessary tools, yeah, to study, to enhance their skills and everything. Okay, so I always tell my student that poverty actually is the denying of opportunities. Yeah, opportunities that sometimes will be taken for granted by those who have, yeah, but for them it is a huge thing. Yeah, so this research try to highlight this issue. So as I said, you know, I've been doing this kind of things from till 2009 when I came back from my PhD. So I got some grant talking about financial abilities, employment patterns of single mother's household, yeah, and then about empowerment, the same thing about financial ability, yeah, and then today I will briefly share with all of you my research finding from my RUI, yeah, Research University Grant. The title is An Investigation of Economic and Financial Well-being of Single Mother Household in Malaysia, the Sole Breadwinner and Care Provider. This grant, I just finished this grant early this year, and yeah, we found some very interesting thing, and thanks to Al-Bukhari International University, to AIU, and now I have another grant to work on, and still talking about single parent household, and yeah, of course it's about single mother household in Balin Kedah. So thank you so much. So just a brief literature review, yeah, because otherwise it will be like so long. Yeah, so child support payment is the most important resource to help ease the financial burden of women with children following a divorce, yeah, and as we know, especially for single mothers, they would have a strict budget by planning and prioritizing their expenditure, yeah, to make up for the financial shortfall, because now they will only have one source of income, because during their marriage they will have the income from the husband, but now they will have to be on their own. That's why the child support payment is very, very important to maintain their financial well-being. And the single mothers are keen and willing to earn their own living by paid employment. Yeah, of course, in Malaysia, we cannot rely, the single mother cannot rely on the government assistance per se. Yeah. Some of them, they will get the help, but the amount wouldn't be sufficient. And however, they are likely to leave if the paid wages is inadequate to meet the basic needs of the family, such as accommodation, transportation, and childcare. And the rising cost of childcare may lead to single mothers to settle for lower quality care or opt for informal care. Informal care meaning that they will send the children to their parents, to their neighbors, to their siblings, to look after their children. And of course, we know that this kind of childcare, they do not have like a proper syllabus to teach the children and everything, compared to the properly paid care. Yeah. The availability and affordability of childcare is the most common challenge for working single mothers. And even if they can find an affordable childcare, it is difficult for many single mothers to stay in the workforce to pursue for a better and flexible job. Therefore, they will settle for lower wages. Okay, as long as they can be close to the children. And during the interview, they will tell that I just work here close to my children so I can get them from school, so I can send them to school so they can go out to work at better places. Yeah. So therefore, childcare quality and childcare costs may affect the employment decision of single mothers. Yeah. So in this case also, child support payment is crucial in helping mothers in raising the children so they can pay for proper childcare for the children that can improve, improve or enhance or develop the quality of the children, from the early age. So I just share some results from my RUI grant. Yeah, so it is, we have 96 respondents. Actually, we have 110, but some of the respondents were dropped from the analysis because they did not fulfill the inclusion criteria. So this study has been conducted in the Peninsula Malaysia. We have to exclude Sabah and Sarawak because it's very, very costly. Yeah. In the northern region, we have Penang, Kedah, Perlis, Perak. Yeah, we have Penang 16, Kedah 10, Perlis 6, Selangor, and then middle region we have Selangor, Nisnan, Wilayah. Southern region we have Kelantan, Terengganu, and Pahang. And southern region we have Melaka and Johor. And I've collected this data myself and with the help of my postgraduate students. Yeah, so we divided the respondent according to the region. This is not easy actually, because we know there are so many single mothers, but they are the vulnerable group. Yeah, so we have to use many channels. We have to use the snowballing technique, and we have to ask. We need to get the data and write letters to Jabatan Kebajikan Masyarakat. Yeah, to and then probably we go to Zakat and also to many, many other sources. And we also ask the respondent to introduce us to another single mother that they know. Yeah, and also to AIM group. So even though it looks easy, but it's not easy actually to find the single mother. And this single mother, they are not like, what we call it, openly admit they are the single mothers. Yeah, because they are stigma involved in this kind of things. Yeah, they are so, unfortunately in our society, the stigma of single mother is still exists. Yeah, it's very much exists. Yeah, even though some of them they just don't care about whatever people say about them. Yeah. So in this table I have the duration of single motherhood, age of the single mothers, and the number of children of the mothers. So the whole sample, you can just focus on the divorced mothers because we are talking about child support. So we talk about more on the divorced single mothers. Yeah. So as you can see here, the average is 6 years, and the maximum is 20 years, and they've been living as a single mother. And we have the age of 44 is the average. And then the average number of children is 4. And you can see the maximum number is 11. Yeah? And actually, they are from 4 to, they have from 1 to 11 actually. Yeah. So if we look at the number of the children for these single mothers, they are even the average, yeah, even the average is higher than the national average. And it's very, very common to see that they have 5 children, 4 or 5 children. Yeah, when for Malays, the average number of children is 3 actually. Yeah, and the number of dependent children, they have 3 on average, and the maximum is 9. And the number of children in school, average is 2 and maximum is 8. Can you just imagine how much money that they need, yeah, to put the children in school? And some of these mothers, when we went to interview them, they were saying that their children are very bright, but they don't have the money to pay for them to pursue their studies. And some of them, they drop out when they were like in form 2, in form 3. This is very, very, actually, it's a sad thing, yeah, for me as a researcher to go to them, and that's what I hear from them. Okay, and we can see that the mother were living in such a hard life, and their children would be in that kind of life too, because we always want something better for our children. And when these kind of things happen, when the poverty struck, you know, and they don't have an enough support from the father, and then this kind of poverty will keep going on from one generation to the next. Yeah, and we find that some of the children, they also got married very, very early, and the mother also got married early when they were like 17, 18, 19, or even 16. And then the children of that mother also got married very early. Yeah, some of them did not have even SPM, so they stopped schooling when they were like 15 or 16. So this is a very sad scenario. So you can see here, for divorced mothers, divorced mothers, primary school 7, yeah, SPM, PMR of 83, 13, SPM 35, STP 8, yeah, on average. Yeah, and you can see the monthly income, the average monthly income is only 841, and the minimum 200. And I was like, how can you live with 200 ringgit? Yeah, now can you just imagine? And then the maximum is to 3,000, because this one with a higher education, educational attainment. Yeah, only a few of them. Just for you know, comparison, you can see the widowed mothers on the next row. You can see the primary school 4, SRP 7, and the SPM 19. So yeah, it's not much different actually. Okay, the type of employment. So we can see that those working in the formal sectors, only 24%. Yeah, working in informal sector, self-employment or part-time worker, the percentage is higher at 60%. Yeah, and 16% or 15 of them were not working. Yeah. So for those who are working in the formal sector, you can see that they have like involved in petty businesses. So they're selling nasi lemak, they're selling kuih muih, yeah, and then curry puff frozen, and also taking care of someone else's children for a small fee, because they're living in a village, yeah, small village. So they just do that so that they can get some money, while at the same time they're looking after their own children. Okay. The respondent who did not work stated childcare and health issue. Yeah, childcare and health issue as their main reasons. Those who had jobs in formal sectors were better off, even though some of them were only as cleaners with cleaning companies, and the pays were relatively low but stable. Okay, they need the money, even though they can get paid only like 1,000 ringgit a month, yeah, and they have like 4 children to feed. single mothers with higher education attainment had better jobs and much better pay. That's why we see just now some of them got like 3,000, the maximum numbers is 3,000 ringgit per month, yeah, because they have diplomas or they have STP or they're working as a nurse or clerk. So when we go deeper, we look at those unemployed single mothers, the divorced ones. So the reason childcare, and this R2 respondent, she got a disabled child, yeah, and she got 220 from JKM and 350 from Pusat Zakat. For R3 childcare and illnesses, for R4 she had been terminated because she got involved in an accident and then she was terminated by her employer. And then for R5 multiple illnesses, she got from JKM 300 ringgit. Illness, childcare, including two children with disability. Okay, if you look at R09, she got two disabled children, and she got only 400 ringgit from Pusat Zakat and others neighborhood more. So this is a good thing as well. Yeah, for the neighbors to look after the family. Yeah, and okay. Got only 120 from neighborhood most, and for R10, the issue is childcare, R11 illness, and for R14 chronic illness. Okay, she got JKM 100 and also from SOXO, yeah, invalidity pension. I think they call it pension ELAC, so she got 850. Actually, she was very sick, yeah. Okay. So child support payment. If you look, we look at the divorced mothers, and the number of respondents that receive child support is only 14, whereby 48 of them did not receive any child support from the absent father. So 77% of them did not receive child support from the father. We will ask why. Well, why is that? Why is happened? What happened? Yeah, when 70% of them did not receive any child support from the father. So from these 62 respondents, yeah, the average number of them is 4, and I think only one of them that have 11 children. Okay. So the table shows that the number of divorced mothers who did not receive child support payment from the absent father is triple than those who received. It is important to note that even among the recipient of child support, the amount is oftentimes insufficient. Okay. You will be surprised to know how much sometimes the amount of the child support that they receive. Yeah, sometimes it's only like 50 ringgit per month, and they have three children to feed. Okay, in qualitative research, we have teams, so I just going to present as one team and not for all of them actually. I just a few of them my respondent. Otherwise, we will have like a very long presentation. So the team that I want to discuss here is the lack of support from children's father. Yeah. So our first respondent that I want to present here is we call her Nora, it's her pseudonym. Yeah. And her her husband was already under the police custody for substance abuse. Yeah. Drug addict. When she wanted a divorce, her husband had boldly made her promise not to ask for child support in return for a divorce. This is not the first time I heard about this. Other cases as well. The husband will say that if you want a divorce, then you don't ask anything from me. Okay? This is not the first time. Okay, because she had gone through so much, so she agreed. Even though this kind of cases will not stand in Sharia court because the father has the utmost or the sole responsibility to provide for his or children. There is no such thing that I give you divorce and I don't have to pay for child support. Okay. At the time of the interview, the father was already released from the prison. He then got remarried and had another child. So Nora still refused to claim for child support for her four young children. She got four young children and she actually is not in good health. She got she has asthma, yeah, and she has to look after 4 children, and luckily she got a house from her late parents. Yeah, so she's living in that house, so she don't have to pay any rentals. Okay, and I think she got some also some money from from the rubber, you know, ladang getah, from her late parents as well, to support, yeah, to support her income. So she said, I don't want to claim the child support payment now because his new wife might get involved and make things worse. That's her reason. Okay, and also it will be very, very hassle, yeah, to go through the process because she lives in a village quite far from the Syariah court. If she wants to go back and forth from the Syariah court, it will cost her so much, and she got only one motorbike, yeah, and it's not yet paid in full. Okay, so she's doing a part-time bidding job for a small commission. She had to go to this respondent from Malacca, so she had to go to Malacca and get the design and the bids and everything, and then she will go back to her village, yeah, which is about 1 hour by car, and will take her longer if she use public transport. And she got like RM50 each for the design. Okay, and she, from that amount, she had to pay for all her own transportation to go and get the job, and then deliver the finished product. Okay, another respondent, we call her Yati, a pseudonym as well. So Yati got divorced when her 3 children were very, very young, and I think the last one was only probably one. Yeah. One. The eldest was 6, and the youngest was 1. So her former husband rarely came home, and they were separated for quite some time before the actual divorce occurred. Yeah. Her former husband did not regularly and sufficiently provide for the children even before the divorce, and she did not claim for child support in court. And her reason being, she said, I know very well of his attitude. He didn't care about the children since they were little. I didn't claim for child support knowing how difficult it's going to be. 1 or 2 times won't be enough to settle the claim. I don't even have a formal custody of the children to start the proceeding, because if she wanted to start the proceeding, to claim for child support, she need to have that formal custody order. Yeah. It's up to him to provide for the children. He is supposed to know his responsibility well. Okay, already divorced for 11 years. Okay, so it's like a norm, a norm, you know, in question mark, a norm for the father for not paying the child support from the very beginning, even during their marriage. So it would be like impossible. She thought that it would be like impossible for the father to pay for child support after the divorce. And the father always gave a reason that he didn't have enough money and he didn't have like a proper job. Okay. And lucky for Yati, because she's living close to her parents and also to her siblings. So during her very hard time, she got help from her own family members. And another respondent, we call her Intan. So Intan's former husband developed a drug addiction later in life. No, not from when they were young, but later in life, when she was already pregnant with their 5th son. Yeah. He was working, but all the money was used to buy drugs. Yeah. Apart from that, her former husband treated her and her children well. That's why when she asked for divorce because of the drug addiction, the former husband was very, very reluctant to let them go, because he loved his children, but once the addiction took place, it's very, very hard for him to get out of it. Yeah. So nevertheless, Intan decided to request for divorce despite her husband's refusal. She had finally got to file for divorce with the help of the legal aid bureau. Yeah, when her husband was arrested for drug abuse. And in her own account, she said that the court informed me that I could claim for child support, but I didn't. He was a drug addict, so I think it's going to be difficult. So much hassle. I just didn't want to go through it. I prefer to raise the children by myself. Needless to ask for his help. and Intan choose to get divorced to keep the children away from drug influence. If I'm not mistaken, when I interviewed this respondent, she was saying that at one point, she found out that the husband took his young children to the ladang kelapa sawit, you know, and do his drug thing, and even the small son, I think the small son, he knew already how to use all the drug paraphernalia. So she was so scared, so she decided to leave. Yeah, she didn't want her children to be drug addicts as well. And some women had to take the breadwinning role even during the marriage. Okay, this is also the reality in our society. Rose's former husband did not have a regular paying job. So she took most of the responsibility for her breadwinner herself. She had claimed for child support. In this case, she claimed, yeah, she had claimed for child support after the divorce, but her former husband did not attend any of the court hearings. This is also a problem for those who claim for child support. The former husband simply didn't turn up. Okay, and I have another case in Malacca whereby the mother had, you know, go to the court so many times. Even the police go and caught the wife and drag him to the court. Yeah, because he was like had done court contempt. Yeah, because he did not respected. She did not respect the court order. And her experience with child support was expressed. She said there's no child support at all. He gave all sorts of excuses for not paying. I went to the court to make official claim. I claimed for the custody as well, but he did not come. Yeah, he did not come. Every time the court calls, he didn't come. So it was only me pursuing the case. After a while, I withdrew the case because she also had to go to do her job because she's working at a childcare, so she couldn't be away for many days. Yeah, otherwise her pay will be cut. And for Rose, it is a bit it is a sad story. Yeah, because she had a history of emotional and physical abuse. Yeah, and I think I was told that the final rule was the husband beat her so badly at one point, and then she finally got to get the divorce. Before that, she was like stand the abuse because of the children, and even the children were so upset with the father for doing that kind of thing to the mother, and they were happy that the mother finally got a divorce. Yeah. In Rose's case, she might not get the right advice. She was told that the case could not be settled because her former husband refused to come. However, according to an officer at the Sharia Judiciary Department that I met, I told him about this, and he told me that actually the court can make decision without the father's presence. Yeah, she did not get this information. So in the end, she dropped the claim. Yeah, and another respondent, Sarah, left her work after getting married. And so she was a full-time homemaker. So she had no source of income other than from her husband. Therefore, she had to ask for child support payment from her former husband, yeah, to support her two young boys, aged 9 and 5. One of his son has an undiagnosed, yeah, learning difficulty. After when I interviewed her, I asked her to go to the hospital to get her son tested. Yeah, because she, if his claim as a OKU, so he can get some help. Yeah, from JKM and everything. So she said every time I ask for child support, it will end up in a fight. Yeah, after the divorce, I had asked him to pay for child support because I was economically in a bad shape. Yeah, she got no work before. I was working before I got married. He asked me to quit my job afterwards and I obeyed him. Then after we got the divorce, I had to leave the house without anything. I tried to ask for some money for the children, but we would get into a fight. He would bluntly ask for sex sometimes in return for the money. That was always the reason for the fight. Yeah, I have no interest in fighting with him because it's exhausting. Yeah, he would only give like 100 or 150. It wasn't much and it's not even worth the fight. And this is not a regular payment. And the sad thing about this, Sarah, is that the husband can earn a lot, actually. He earned a lot because he was, I think he's still working with a oil company. Yeah, he got a lot, but she didn't know where the money has gone. Yeah, and she also didn't get any help from the family of the fathers, and they were from a well-to-do family as well. Okay, this thing keeps, you know, this keep resurfacing. Yeah, when I go to different places. Yeah. Even though the family of the father should be able to pay, are able to pay, but they rarely do so. Even though that's their own flesh and blood. Yeah. So many women fight for custody of their children post divorce. Yeah, there are some. Yeah, many of them fight as well. They want to stand for the right of their children. Yeah, Aida is one of them. She found out there was an indication that her former husband would take one of the three children away. She got three children, two girls and one boy. Yeah, so during their dealings, their husband said that if you keep asking for child support, I will take away one of the children. Aida would never allow for split custody, hence she did not write anything in the child support section in the divorce form. Yeah. Consequently, no formal child support claim was made and she got all her children living with her. So she was hoping that the father would voluntarily pay for child support. Yeah. He could afford to pay for child support, but he rarely did. And this is also the case that I said, the family of the father are able to pay or able to help the children. Yeah, for their schooling and for their daily expenses, but they didn't. And another sad thing is that they live in the same village, okay, close by. And the elder daughter, she got quite a serious problem, eyes problem actually, and she already went through, I think, two or three surgery, yeah, to fix her eyes. Yeah, she got some very big issue with her eyes, and she's also in the university now. Okay. He knew that I have a job, so he just washed his hands off. I felt so angry just before the school started. I had headache thinking about all the expensive school fees, uniform for my children, and she was really hoping that the family, the uncles and the aunts of her children would help with this, you know, school uniform or shoes or whatever, but they didn't. And also, the same as Rose, Aida had a history of mental abuse and domestic violence by her drug addict husband. Okay, so we could see that a few things, actually many cases, that I had encountered the husband were drug addicts. Yeah, so actually drug addiction is a huge problem in our society. She said that I have a job, but she's not like have a regular job, regular paying job. She's working in a gerai makan, food store. If she got a job on that day, she will be paid. Otherwise, she won't be paid. And she was badly affected by the COVID-19 when the food stall did not operate. Look at the counts of these single mothers, except for Yati, we find that their non-employment in formal sectors during the marriage had worsened their financial well-being. Yeah? In an effort to provide for the children themselves, they have to find work to sustain their family. And of course, as we said just now, they only have like low-paying jobs. Yeah? And during this COVID-19 pandemic, some of the respondents have lost their jobs, right? And things were worse for them. If you could see the photo, you know, the caricature actually, in this slide, it was Aida's profile at one point. And I asked her what happened. She said, "I think things are getting so hard for me." Yeah. Only very recently. As a conclusion, we find that only some mothers obtain child support through legal channel, while others do not, as the cost and hassle related to the claim. We also find that irresponsible behavior of the fathers has created a huge problem to mothers seeking payment. This is especially true when we find that the father can afford to pay, but they just choose not to pay, or they do not want to pay sufficient amount. Yeah? Despite the hardship they endure in order to put food on the table, these independent single mothers take pride in their ability to financially provide for their family. Okay, when I did my interviews, yeah, you could see that sometimes they will put up, you know, happy faces, and they will chat with each other, because usually I will have them in the group. Huh? But once you start interviewing them, some of them will cry. And as a researcher, we cannot do much. Yeah, we have to be very neutral. But this experience is very, very humbling, actually. Okay, very humbling, whereby we can see that they are really struggle. They really struggle to raise their children. So living in poverty, single mothers need assistance in order to achieve a better financial well-being for their children. Sustainable social support and specific welfare assistance could reduce the burden of single mothers in fulfilling their daily needs. Particularly among single mothers living in rural areas with very low income. This is where our research with the grant from AIU fits in. Okay, we're going to try to develop a sustainable livelihood for single mothers or single parent families. When we talk about single parent family, we mostly talk about single parent, single mothers household. Yeah. So this is really, really jive, yeah, with the spirit of my research. Yeah? And thank you to AIU for having my team and I, and also team from other universities, yeah, to get involved in this kind of research. In addition, their life experience revealed that they need more than monetary help to improve their well-being, and that help include assistance in education, transportation, and also asset accumulation. Okay. And as we know, developed nations have gone through reform on child support policy, yeah, to minimize child poverty. Therefore, there is an urgent call for the Malaysian government to reform the policy to improve the livelihood of low-income single mothers, yeah, and to avoid the persistence of child poverty and intergenerational poverty. I think that's all that I want to share with you, and forgive me for my shortcomings. Yeah, thanks for your time. If you have any problem, then you can probably ask. I think we have another few minutes here, Prof.
Thank you, Dr. Zarina. Very insightful sharing session about the true stories of the single mothers based on your research experience. So I think we can open up for the Q&A session. We have Dr. Zu, counselor. We have Dr. Kalso. Or maybe I want to start first.